Hello and welcome to our Sunday gathering for the 31st of May. I'm James Leach and I'm a member of the team here at St. James. It's Pentecost Sunday and all around the world, Christians are celebrating the pouring out of God's Holy Spirit on his people. At a time when our buildings may be closed, we rejoice that God has made us, his people, to be a temple in which his Holy Spirit dwells. And so as we begin our time together, let me lead us in prayer. Let's pray. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful people and kindle in us the fire of your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In our opening song, we're going to thank God for the gifts of his Son and of his Spirit as we sing, There is a Redeemer. And Lindsay Mackie is going to lead us. Please do join in.
God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till done. Jesus, my Redeemer, name above all names, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, oh, for sinners slain. Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till the work on earth is done. When I stand in
Well, hopefully members of St. James are getting familiar with our new hashtag St. James Together bulletin that goes out with the email invitation for this Sunday gathering. In there you'll find, for example, details of how to contribute to the leaving gifts for the Wilsons and the Mansells and Debbie Hines, either by cheque to the office or by direct bank transfer. Details in the bulletin. A couple of other things to tell you about that are happening this week. Our new Christianity Explored course starts up online on Tuesday night, led by Jan and Gary Palmer. There should hopefully be a link below this video, or you can just go to the St. James website and click on the Explore tag. It's a great course if you've got questions about the Christian faith, or invite someone else, a friend of yours, who has questions like that. Starts Tuesday night. And then on Wednesday, it's our monthly prayer gathering. Not only do we gather via Zoom for the vital work of prayer, but also to share the latest updates on what's going on in the life of the church. So don't miss out on that. You'll be getting a link via a separate email, and see you on Wednesday night. Now, one of the things that we try and do in these Sunday gatherings is to keep everyone updated on the various areas of ministry in our life together as a church. So you may remember a couple of weeks ago, Guy Mansell shared with us details of a great resource for families. This week, our focus is on what's going on with our youth, with our young people, because youth ministry has by no means come to a halt during lockdown. So here's Welsh, a member of our youth team, to tell us what's going on.
Hi, my name is Welsh, and I'm one of the youth workers here at St. James. I am part of an amazing team of committed volunteers who are also passionate about young people. And in a few weeks, the new youth pastor, Ross, will be joining us, and we're really looking forward to the new energy and the wisdom that you bring to the youth ministry at St. James. So please do be praying for Ross and his family as they prepare to move. Since lockdown, we have had to take our youth ministry at St. James online, and we have created amazing and safe online spaces where our young people could continue to grow in their relationship with the Lord Jesus and in their understanding of God's word. We have created spaces that allows our young people to continue to build and maintain relationships with one another while having loads and loads of fun together. Every Sunday at 8 a.m., we put out a youth talk on the St. James YouTube channel. And we've just finished our series on the book of James about being wholehearted Christians. And we are currently looking at different individual topics from God's word just to encourage each other during this time of lockdown. On Tuesdays on Zoom, we have two Bible study sessions. One for the River, which is for the 11 to 14 year olds, and Echo for the 15 to 18 year olds. And we are currently studying the book of Colossians together. And we are thinking through what it really means to be Christians in terms of the responsibility and the privileges that come with it. Every once in a while, we put out a podcast on the St. James website. These podcasts are designed to help us to develop a biblical worldview. We've just finished a series on suffering, and Ben Clark has been helping us to think through how we should approach suffering as Christians. On Fridays, we have two Friday Night Live sessions on Zoom, and it's a great opportunity to hang out and have loads of fun together. It's very chilled. Lots of games, lots of catching up. It's all about having fun together. Now, if you're a young person watching this, we would love to see you. We would love to connect with you. So please do engage with our online spaces. And if you're a parent of a young person watching this, please do encourage them to connect with our online spaces. And it'll be great if you guys could watch the YouTube videos together. And if you're watching this and feeling a bit detached from youth and thinking to yourself, how can I be part of this? How can I help? It'll be great if you could pray for us. Our young people are currently facing loads of challenges at the moment. Challenges regarding homeschooling. They're not able to meet friends as normal. And there's lots of uncertainty regarding exams being cancelled and whether they'll be able to go to the university that they wanted to go to. So please do pray for them during this time. Pray that they would continue to trust and depend on the Lord Jesus, that they would see this as a unique opportunity to continue to grow in their faith.
Thanks, Welsh. It's wonderful, isn't it, to hear how our young people are continuing to meet together and be built up even during lockdown. We have many, many things to thank God for and to praise Him for. And we also have many, many things on our hearts that we want to bring to Him in prayer. Ian Mitten is going to lead us now in song, in singing We Praise You, and then Andy and Jane Ditty are going to lead us in prayer.
Let praise be the weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be the weapon that conquers all anxiety. Well, let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and claim your victory. Well, let it rise. Let praise arise. We see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. God of breakthroughs on our side, forever lifting high, with all creation cry, God, we praise you. Whoa, we praise you. Whoa. Let faith be the song that overcomes the raging sea. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Well, let it rise. Let faith arise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side, forever lifted high, with all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side, forever lifting high, with all creation cry, God, we praise you. Whoa, we praise you. Whoa, we praise you. Whoa, let praise arise.
Hello, I'm Jane Ditty and married to Andy, and we're members of the 630 congregation. Andy uses a device to communicate, so he's going to use that today as we do the prayers. Let's pray.
Heavenly Father, as we come into your presence this day, we worship you that you are the creator and the sustainer of the universe. You called all things into being, and at a time when many of us may be feeling uncertain, or perhaps perhaps anxious, we rejoice that you are Lord of all. Lord Jesus, we worship you, that you are the Saviour and Lord of the world. You came to earth and lived and died so that our sins could be forgiven and we can have a life in eternity with you. And Holy Spirit, we worship you, that you are the sanctifier of the people of God. You dwell among us and bless us with your fruit. We long for more and more of your fruit to ripen in our lives. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, three persons in one God. Amen.
Dear Lord, we confess that we don't always put you in your correct place as our Lord and Saviour, and we try and do things our own way. We need reminding to love you with all our heart and soul, mind and strength. Thank you for your mercy, and forgive us for our independence, and help us to be totally dependent on you for everything. We confess that we're selfish and focus on our own needs, forgetting the needs of our neighbours. Help us to love our neighbours as ourselves and show us how we can do that practically. Amen. We know that all things work together for good for those who love you, and we thank you for the many blessings during this time of lockdown. You're so kind and generous. Thank you for the amazing weather you've blessed us with during the lockdown, for time, for homes and green spaces where we can enjoy your beautiful creation. Amen.
We thank you for Matt and all the leadership team at St. James. We thank you for their faithfulness over this time and for finding new ways of connecting and encouraging us with your word. We also thank you for the new team members about to join us, for us McGavin, who will lead our youth work, for Anna Barrett, our new children's pastor, and for James Ford, who will lead us on mission. We ask that you would bless them as they move and settle into this area, and lead and direct them in their new areas of ministry with us. Amen.
Amen. We pray for an end to the virus, for the researchers and medics to work together to find a vaccine, for good communication and cooperation, and may the world see your goodness through this. We pray for all those in positions of authority, particularly our government. Please give them your wisdom to make good decisions, particularly as they work out the best way to relax the lockdown. Thank you for all of our key workers, for all those working in the NHS who have been so dedicated, for those who collect our bins each week, and those working for supermarkets and delivery firms so that we can all stay safe. Please help them to get the rest they need and sustain them. As the primary schools begin to open up, we pray for wisdom, grace and peace for head teachers and their teaching staff. And in particular, we lift Nicola Flower, the head teacher of the Church of England School here in Gerrards Cross, to you. We thank you for families. We pray particularly for those with children. Please give them extra energy, patience, joy and grace as they resume homeschooling after the half-term break. Loving Father, you place the lonely into families, and we thank you for the church family. Please open our eyes and help us to meet the needs of our neighbours where we can and connect with anyone who's lonely, particularly at this time of isolation. We pray for ourselves that we may know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly day by day. Amen.
We ask that you would give Christians all over the world the courage and the words to share the good news of Jesus Christ and the hope you bring. May this be a time of many, many people turning to you, and help us and show us how to be good and effective witnesses for you. We thank you for all the amazing technology that we have. We pray that you would give us the opportunities to share your love with those who do not yet know you in the week ahead of us, and help us to be encouragers to those seeking to follow you. May we help others to love you more. Amen.
Amen. We'll finish by praying the Lord's Prayer together. Please join us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Andy and Jane. Now I wonder, what do you think is the most important question that Jesus was ever asked? I suppose, are you the Christ, might be one candidate. Perhaps you can think of others. In our reading from Mark's Gospel today, we hear another great question and Jesus' answer that goes right to the heart of how we live our lives. Wendy Shingleton is going to read our passage for us, and then Matt Beebe will open up the scriptures for us.
Hello, my name is Wendy Shingleton and I attend the 9 o'clock at Gerrard's Cross. The reading is taken from Mark 12, beginning at verse 28. One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" "The most important one," answered Jesus, "is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." "Well said, teacher," the man replied. "You are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. To love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, and with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions.
Hi everyone, great to be with you today. My name's Matt, I lead the team here at St James. And if like me, you've been able to enjoy a few days off over the past week, then I hope you're enjoying this glorious weather. It's so good that we thought we'd go for another outside broadcast. We're back, of course, into Mark's Gospel today, back into our series on the Servant King. And I'm going to pray for us now as we open up God's Word. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that as we open up your Word together now, you are speaking to us. And we want to pray that you would soften our hearts to that work of your Spirit, that we might see the Lord Jesus more clearly, that we might understand more of what it means to live life in his kingdom. And we pray, Father, that your word might take hold of our affections, that we might love Jesus more and more. In his name we pray. Amen. Well, perhaps understandably, people get a little nervous at the mention of religion. After all, some of the rituals and the ceremonies can feel a little bit out of date, perhaps especially if you didn't grow up with those things. Or the rules can feel overly restrictive, a little bit like living your life under some kind of moral lockdown. And where's the fun in any of that? But what we're discovering in Mark's Gospel is that Jesus didn't have time for ritual and ceremony as a means of accessing God. And he didn't come simply to show us how to live a better life. In fact, the rituals of folk religion and the morality of human religion will get us nowhere, he said. when it comes to being right with God. So we might then ask, well, what then is true religion? What is life in God's kingdom really all about? Well, go back to the first great awakening in North America in the 18th century, and a man called Jonathan Edwards was a pastor in Northampton, Massachusetts, at a time when many people gave their lives to Christ. And he famously wrote that true religion consists in great part of the affections. In other words, it's all about the heart. Now, it's tempting, of course, to think that affections and emotions are the same thing. Actually, they're different. The affections are long-lasting, and yet, of course, so often our emotions tend to be quite fleeting. They come and go. The affections are deep, and yet, of course, so often our emotions can be quite superficial. Our affections, of course, are always consistent with our core beliefs. But our emotions, of course, can so often overpower us in terms of what we know to be true. So when a young girl, for example, leaves home to go to university, her emotions may tell her as she packs her bag not to go. She knows she'll miss friends and family. She's nervous about life in a new city. She might even consider changing her plans to live and study at home. But then she recognizes her fleeting emotions for what they are, that they're feelings that come and go. They're feelings that are not produced by that deep, settled conviction she has that now is the time to start a new chapter. And her affections are that deep conviction. Her affections are what produce the inclinations that govern her actions. And so she packs her bag. And she heads off to begin her new life. Well, in the same way in the Christian life, it is our affections for God that shape our lives so that we are governed not by our emotions or how we feel in the moment, but rather by something altogether much deeper. And we're thinking today about how true religion roots itself, not in how we feel, but in what we know in our affections. Now, we talk a lot at the moment, don't we, about the new normal. And as we speculate about what life after lockdown might look like, we know that some things will go back to normal, whilst others will almost certainly never be the same again. The world is changing. And it's the same here in Mark's Gospel. The kingdom of God, which Jesus has come to establish, heralds a new world order. And as he comes to establish this kingdom, the religious people of the day don't like Jesus because he brings conflict and confrontation. As representatives of the old Israel, they are threatened by the arrival of Jesus because he comes with this talk of a new Israel. And he exposes their self-righteousness, their reliance on good works. And so there is conflict in Israel as Jesus confronts the old religious system. And now here in this passage, a lawyer comes to Jesus with what is essentially a question about how we're to interpret the Old Testament. It's therefore a question about what it means to be part of this new Israel. Or to put it another way, what is true religion? What's life in the kingdom all about? And Jesus says, it's all about the affections. Not feelings or emotions, they come and go, but rather the deep, settled longings of the will because of what we know to be true about God and his word. Now, how to understand this? Well, we can experience an emotion, of course, without it properly being an affection. But it's very hard to experience an affection without it also stirring our emotions. Because if our affections go to the deepest longings of our hearts, well, then they will overflow into our words and our deeds and our feelings and our emotions because God made us whole beings. And so our affections will shape our whole lives. And that is what Jesus has in view here in this conversation. Here's the question then in verse 28, of all the commandments, which is the most important? The rabbis of the day had studied the Old Testament scriptures and found that altogether there were 613 individual commands. The teachers of the law loved to debate which one was most important. And clearly this man here in verse 28 had studied the law, otherwise he wouldn't be asking the question. But for all his apparent knowledge of the law, he hasn't yet discovered the guiding principle behind it. You see, it's possible to be around Christianity for long enough, perhaps even many years, so that you learn the vocabulary. You become familiar with the liturgy or the style, and you know all the rules, but without your heart ever being changed, without our affections ever being won for Jesus. Well, here Jesus answers this question of all the rules, which is the golden rule. And he does so by showing us that the kingdom of God has only come in our lives when it takes root in our affections. And Jesus talks here about three things concerning the kingdom. The first is this, the God of the kingdom. Here's how Jesus answers the question. Verse 29. Do have your Bible open at home so you can follow with me. Verse 29. The most important one, answered Jesus, is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. Jesus is quoting here what's known as the Shema from Deuteronomy chapter 6. Pious Jews recited this at least twice a day. The teacher of the law here would have learned it in the synagogue as a boy. And it speaks a truth and then a command. Because understanding leads to action. Jonathan Edwards spoke of two faculties of the human soul, the understanding by which we discern what is true and the will by which we commit to a particular action. In other words, truth working from the mind through to the heart. And where our minds understand the truth, our hearts are compelled to action. So here's the truth. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. Now in the NIV, there's a footnote which offers a slightly different translation, but the most helpful alternative is from Deuteronomy 6 itself, where the Hebrew text translates as, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. In other words, a statement of exclusivity. There is one God, not many. God alone is God, and there is no other. That is the truth of the Old Testament, which Jesus now upholds here in the New Testament. God alone is God. Verse 32, there is no other but Him. Now, of course, in our sinfulness as human beings, we've denied the absolute truth of God's word and called it pluralism. We've worshipped a whole host of other gods and called it multiculturalism, and we've used words like that to make it more palatable. But of course, the Bible tells us that to worship anyone or anything else other than God Himself is idolatry. Because God alone is God. That's the truth in verse 29. Now here's the command in verse 30. We're to love God, says Jesus, because He alone is God. Therefore, He alone is worthy of our praise and our worship, or if you like, our affections. And the exclusivity of the truth here demands an exclusivity of action. Love Him, says Jesus, with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. If God alone is God, then He deserves not some, but all. Now, of course, without some definition here, then the word love is a pretty vacuous word, and we're easily confused, aren't we? You know, we love Britain's Got Talent, we love Joe Wicks, we love a steak dinner. And for me, at least one of those three things is true. So what does love actually mean? If we're not careful, we empty the word of any real meaning. Well, the Bible speaks of three types of love. Filial love, brotherly, friendship love. Eros love, passionate, erotic love. And then agape love, sacrificial, self-giving love. And the word Jesus uses here is the agape word. John Stott, who was at All Souls Church, Langham Place in London for many years, described this kind of love as self-sacrifice, which arises from respect and issues in service. So we give ourselves sacrificially to God out of respect, because He alone is God. And we do so in service, because our affections shape our actions. If you like, from our heads, what we understand, to our hearts, which drive our will, to our hands, in all of life. This is the kind of love which determines the whole orientation of your life, because God alone deserves our affections. Apparently, 1 in 4 of the population in the UK is now attending church online in some shape or form. So 25%, where the previous UK average before COVID-19 hit was 6%. And I guess we should be encouraged. There does seem to be a greater spiritual openness in our society just at the moment. But we shouldn't get carried away, as if God should somehow be pleased that His ratings are up as more of us make time for Him alongside our other interests. God isn't needy. It's not that He's really hoping that we might make a bit more time for Him. Jesus says here, there is one God, not many. Which means you cannot serve other gods. We cannot put God in a box alongside all our other passions, and like a child with his toy, we pick and choose every morning which one we might play with. I don't know about you, but all too often that is what I do with God. I make time for him, or I talk to him when I choose to, or when I need him, but then I put him back in the box and I get on with other things. And when I do that, I reduce him down just to a sort of minifigure. One of a collection of things that I have, of gods that I serve. And Jesus says to us here, there is no other but him. So what will it look like then for God to command our affections? Well, it means we won't be ruled by our emotions and by how we feel in the moment. Rather, we will be governed in all our choices by what we know to be true about God. And we'll trust that He knows best for our lives how we will flourish in this world. And so we'll surrender every other passion, every other interest that we have, all the other gods that we worship, to Him. Because at the heart of our affections, we know that there is no other but God. And when we do that, we begin an adventure in which every day we learn to ask, how can I best love Jesus in this situation, whatever it might be, with all that I've got? So first then, the God of the kingdom. Then second, the ethics of the kingdom. In verse 31, Jesus quotes from Leviticus 19, saying, look, the second is this, love your neighbour as yourself. Asked here which is the most important commandment, Jesus replies with two, but common to both is the command and the guiding principle of agape love. That's why Jonathan Edwards said, love is the chief of the affections and the fountain of them. So it's the chief of the affections because it's right at the heart of what the scriptures are all about, love for God and love for neighbour. And it's the fountain of the affections because out of love flows everything else. If we love God and love our neighbour, well then every other command will start to make sense. And these two commands here are profoundly related. You cannot separate them. When Jesus says, love God, he places God right at the heart of the law. When he says, love your neighbour, he places other people next in line. Because you cannot do the vertical without also doing the horizontal. You cannot love God and then not in turn love your neighbour. Why not? Because the story of the Bible is the story of God's love for this world such that he sent his son to die for you and your neighbour. God loves you and your neighbour. And so to love God and yet neglect your neighbour, well, that just doesn't fit, does it? It's a little bit like the young man who respects his father-in-law. you know, he does all the right things out of respect for his wife's father before they get engaged. He asks him for his daughter's hand in marriage. Call it old-fashioned, but that's the way he does it. He's careful when he visits his in-laws to do everything correctly. He has a shave, he dresses smartly, he has his hair cut, all the things that some of us aren't able to do just at the moment. And he's very careful about polite conversation. He respects his father-in-law. Or so it seems. Because away from the family home, back at their flat, he's actually quite rude to his wife. He shows no interest in her friends or her work. He's short-tempered, he's unkind. He stays out late with his mates. When he's questioned about it, he gets angry. In fact, his attitude to his wife is bordering on the abusive. He claims to respect his father-in-law, but then you look at how he treats that man's daughter, his wife, and you realize that it's a lie. It doesn't fit. It doesn't work. You see, you cannot love God without also loving your neighbor. The Apostle John, 1 John 4, says, "Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar." No matter how hard you try, you cannot love your neighbor if you don't first love God. That's true. We can try and do it. Many people do. We try and cut God out of the picture and ignore him and then focus on loving the people around us. And at best, we can make a go of it. But the truth is, we easily become proud and self-righteous. And we think we're a little bit better than everyone else. And what happens gradually is that what we do for others is done not out of love, but out of pity. And we start to feel superior. It has to start with God. Without God, we cannot truly love with agape love. We just end up loving people out of self-love because it makes us feel good, because it makes us feel we've earned our place with God. No, agape love, self-giving, sacrificial love, that only flows out of us when we first have experienced it from God in our own lives. And then we need to ask here the question, who is my neighbour? In Leviticus 19, neighbour was defined as the sons of your own people. In other words, people like us. That, of course, is easy. We make a cultural assessment, don't we, of the people around us. It's subconscious, but we're sort of doing it. Ethnicity, socioeconomic criteria, whatever it might be. And we look out for our own. But in the parable of the Good Samaritan in Luke chapter 10, Jesus blows the category of neighbour wide open. When he says we're to show mercy to anyone, regardless of whether or not they deserve it. Doesn't matter whether you have anything in common with them, says Jesus. And so very simply, my neighbour, we discover, is anyone in any kind of need, whose need I know about and can meet, irrespective of whether I think they are worthy of my help. At which point all the barriers, racial, cultural, social, economic, whatever they might be, all the barriers come tumbling down and we discover we are to love anyone and everyone regardless of whether we think they deserve it. Now, I don't know about you, but that's much harder. And that is why we need to love God first. Because without first having a right relationship with him, without having his spirit at work in our hearts, without God being the centre of our affections, we will never be able to love others. Because the power to love comes not from within, but from God himself, in Jesus. So what will it look like then for me to love my neighbour? Well, in verse 30, Jesus says, "Love your neighbour as yourself." And all of us know, don't we, how we'd like to be treated when we're in need. You see, loving your neighbour means asking, what does my neighbour need? It was so encouraging the other day to be asked by a member of the PCC, how can we love the new team members who are due to arrive with us in the next few months? Oh, we've got new staff arriving in the coming weeks, which is really exciting for us as a church family. Here was someone who hasn't yet met any of them asking, what do they need? How can we love them? And I've since discovered that since that question was asked, several people have been reaching out with practical help, and I know others have been praying for these new team members in the background as they prepare to join us. I just think that is wonderful. And it's that kind of love that we want to replicate right across St. James. So newcomers arriving amongst us at the moment need hospitality and friendship. Some of us are struggling with money worries or homeschooling or we're bereaved or lonely, and we just need someone to just reach out and tell us that they're going to walk with us just at the moment. Of course, others amongst us are looking in at the Christian faith as outsiders, and we need someone, don't we, just to walk with us gently so that we might be able to meet Jesus for ourselves. And of course, for all of us here, that is our greatest need, isn't it? Salvation. And so ultimately, we love our neighbour by taking the gospel to anyone we know. So, the God of the kingdom, the ethics of the kingdom, and then briefly, the citizenship of the kingdom. Who it's actually for, who will enter God's kingdom. You see, Jesus' reply here is hardly controversial. Love God, love your neighbour, standard religious stuff, right? But it's the little addition at the end of verse 31 that drops the bomb. Can you see it? There is no commandment greater than these. This is what turns the whole Jewish system on its head. This is where we discover that the lawyer here is onto something. Well said, teacher, he replies. You are right. To love God and love your neighbour, verse 33, is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. This is what gets Jesus killed. Because Jesus is saying that human religion is worthless. And this lawyer can see that if they are not accompanied by heartfelt love for God and other people, then the temple rituals are empty. If this conversation is part of a number where Jesus is sort of fielding questions at a press conference, then here is the headline for tomorrow's papers. Jesus is saying that the Old Testament sacrificial system, with all its rules and requirements, is finished. You see, on our own, we fail to love God and our neighbour as we should. And the burnt offerings and sacrifices were there to remind the Jews of their need to be purified because of that failure. But they were only ever a shadow of the real thing, these temple sacrifices. They were never the reality, because the reality is Jesus Christ himself, who came as the one who did love God with all his heart, soul, mind and strength, and who did love his neighbour, even forgiving those who put him to death. And so he can be the one final perfect sacrifice on our behalf. And because we know he first loved us, we find in his sacrifice at the cross the transforming power which now enables us to love God and love our neighbour as we should. And so Jonathan Edwards, on this idea of true religion, asked this: Can we Christians find anything worthier to respond to with all our affections than what is set forth to us in the gospel of Jesus Christ? Can anything be worthier to affect us than this? When we discover what Jesus has done for us at the cross, we respond not with a burnt offering, but rather by loving God and loving our neighbour with all that we've got. Not to earn God's love, but simply to say thank you. And yet, if we've never discovered God's love for us at the cross, or we've somehow lost sight of the gospel, our lives will look like nothing more than burnt offerings. The rituals and the traditions of folk religion, the morality of human religion, the things we do so that God will bless us. But there's no joy. It doesn't go to our affections. What does God make of all that? Well, have you ever tasted something that's been burned in the oven? It's foul, isn't it? Bitter, no flavour, nothing to taste, all the goodness burnt out of it. And Jesus is saying to this lawyer, to the religious leaders of the day, he's saying to us, If it doesn't come from your affections, well, then it's nothing more than a burnt offering. And that is all your religion amounts to. It's foul to the taste. It's devoid of goodness. And it will not give you life. But for those of us who will come to him in Christ, not through burnt offerings, God welcomes us and he gives us life. And maybe that's this lawyer right here. Jesus concludes by telling him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. It's an encouraging reply. He isn't far. Did he ever make it into the kingdom? Well, we're not told. And it's not the question that matters. See, never mind him. What about us? Maybe you're not far today from the kingdom of God. And maybe you're beginning to see why Jesus has come and how empty human religion really is. Will you now make the step and trust him with your life? Will you turn your back on the burnt offerings of rituals and morality and allow Jesus Christ to win your affections as you discover the joy of eternal life? Will you do that? I'm going to pray that we would all do that. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for showing us today more of what it looks like to live life in your kingdom. And Father, we pray that you might help us to see that true religion consists of the affections. And we pray that as we understand Jesus more and more, he might take a hold of our affections, that our whole lives would be given to him and shaped by him, and that we would learn more and more what it is to love you and to love our neighbor. And Father, whether we've been following Jesus for many years or we're only just today deciding that we want to give our lives to him, would you help us, we pray, to live life with him and for him, and that we would know in all that the joy of eternal life. In his name we pray. Amen. Well, we've learned today that there is no other but God, and so he deserves our highest praise. And that's what we're going to sing about now.
I lift my voice to sing of your goodness. I lift my voice to sing of your love. I lift my voice to sing hallelujah. Jesus, our Savior, you're worthy of it all. And we give you the highest praise. We give you the
So how are we going to love God and love our neighbour this week, as Jesus taught us? Well, whatever opportunities we have, let's remember with gratitude this Pentecost Sunday that God has given us his Spirit to produce within us the fruit of love. There's a prayer that we often use in our communion services towards the end, in which we ask God to send us out in the power of his Spirit. Now, God is sending us out in different ways, I guess, these days. Very often it's via the internet rather than out of our front doors. But it's still a great prayer to pray. So I'm going to finish with that prayer. Let's pray. Almighty God, as we consider your great commandments and as we remember the outpouring of your Spirit, send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. And may your blessing be among us this week and always. Amen. Have a great week.